Thank you, everybody, for coming out this evening. I thought I would start with maybe the most important question we can ask in today's day and age. And that question is, does the world need saving? And what does that mean, right? So are we saving the world from something? So what does it mean to save the world? So take a moment, just think about this for a second. Does the world need saving? So with that question in mind, we immediately have to ask, what is the world, right? What exactly do we mean by world? So world could be the physical world, the actual globe, the place that we live on. It could be the way we see the world, right? So it could be my world and my view of the world. So there's a lot of definitions here. And when we talk about saving the world, which one are we trying to save? So as Dr. Nyhammer so graciously introduced me, I'm Aaron Lawler. I teach humanities here. A couple of things just real quick about me and about my way of approaching this tonight was that I'm a humanist first, which means that I believe, it'll be fine, I believe that we can solve the world's problems and understand the world through human agency, right? So human intellect is what gives us the ability to do this, right? And that we do so in the tradition of the Renaissance, not by studying one thing, but by studying many things, right? So as you can tell by my background, I've studied lots of stuff, and I continue to go to school, and I've been doing so since I was 2 years old, right? So I continue to go and continue to try to learn about the world as I can. I'm also a pluralist, which simply means that I can hold two ideas that are opposing and find merit by them, right? So they might be right or wrong inherently, but I can see them both being useful and actually weigh them equally. But then lastly, and probably most importantly, is I'm an educator. And I believe that what education does isn't just about teaching, it's about teaching ways to solve the world's problems, teaching ways to address those problems, and to be engaged in the world. And so I actually believe education is the solution to all those things that we worry about on a daily basis. All right, so tonight's talk is global awareness, but my plan is to take us through a handful of different ideas. And we're going to start with this notion of perception and perspectives. So how do you see the world? Because we have to start with you, and then we're going to look at how that branches out from you into the bigger culture. We're also going to look at what's known as an optimistic worldview. I'm going to try to dispel this myth that the world's a terrible place. And the big boogeyman's going to come take your job, and you know, globalism's going to come get us. I think that's a bad way to look at things, and so we're going to look at it from a more optimistic worldview. Sorry. Because I'm a humanities teacher and I tend to focus on the humanities as a solution of things, I would be remiss if I didn't mention interconnectedness. This is a thing that comes out of Eastern thought, but it also shows up in physics, it shows up in the arts, it shows up in poetry, and so we're going to spend some time doing that as well. And then lastly, we're going to do this global mindset, which is what does it mean to see the world beyond just your scope? I believe that there's more than one kind of intelligence, right? So there's intelligence where you're smart at reading, or you're smart at writing, or mathematics, or science. But I think you can also be smart in terms of culture, in terms of understanding the world in historical perspectives. And so I think developing that skill is just as important as developing the other skills that I mentioned. We bring that full circle, then all four of those pieces come to what I call as the global optimist, right? Which is this notion that optimists can look at the world's problems and actually solve them because they believe their solutions, where pessimists don't. And as hokey as it might sound, the goal of this is to try to make the world a better place. All right, so that's our plan for tonight. So I'm working from four major inspirations. A humanities teacher, we tend to work from just not one idea, but many ideas. And so I'm going to be working from science, from psychology, sociology, culture, and even literature. So we start with the first one here, which is Daniel Quinn's book known as Ishmael. And it's a fictional story. But Quinn was a philosopher, and he had a hard time getting people to buy into his philosophy. But when he wrote a fictional novel, he got people to listen to his ideas, right? So he used this fictional novel to teach his philosophy to the world. So I started with this premise. And then I added in Harm de Blige's The Power of Place, Harmon Oblige was a human geographer that worked at a Northwestern for about 30 years. And he continued to argue that the American school system was poor, not because of whatever was going on with the American school system, but it's that we taught history classes all the time, and we didn't teach human geography classes. And he said we spent way too much time looking at time and not enough time looking at space. And so we'll work from that model as well. And then these last two are the more scientific kind of models. The first one here by F. David Peet. Peet was a quantum physicist, but he did something really novel in his approach. He went and studied with the Blackfoot tribe. He found that Western science wasn't giving him the answers he needed in order to marry quantum physics with the study of gravity in the universe. He said these ideas don't go together. It's a problem that plagues Western science to this day. But he found solutions by studying what the indigenous taught about physics in the world. And so he looked at it from a very unique perspective. And then lastly, Seligman. So Martin Seligman is a humanist psychologist, which means he stops looking at how we cure psychology as a pathology. So you're not a machine. We can't like take you apart and put you back together. Instead, we look at your strengths, your psychological strengths, the things that you bring to the world, and you use those to overcome issues that you have in your life and the way you solve your problems. So these are the four models I'm working from, and I kind of put them all together to come up with what I call, like I said, the global optimist. All right, so we're going to start with perceptions and perspectives. So I'm a teacher at first, which means I'm going to start with a question. Which of the two circles is largest? Okay, so take a moment, please, and look at the two circles and tell me which of these two do you think is smaller or larger? And I will promise you they are not the same size. All right, everybody got it? Okay. Raise your hand if... if you think this is a trick question and they are the same size circle, this guy's got something up his sleeve. Some of you must have taken my class. Yeah. Ah, I will, but not yet. I like you. You should take my class. If you believe the red circle is larger, go ahead and raise your hand. Good, good. And then the blue. Okay. I did not lie to you. They are, in fact, not the same size circle, right? So the red circle is a hair, but it is larger than the blue. So what does this teach us? It teaches us that there's something going on in our dialogue, in our conversation here. And that something is, can you trust me? Can you trust what I'm saying, right? Part of the problem is this idea of the fear of looking stupid. We all have it. You're going to say, oh, no, it's not me. We all have it. We all have this fear that we don't want to be wrong, right? We don't want to look duped. We don't want to look gullible, right? So you saw those two circles. You're like, this is a tricky college professor. He's up to something. There's no way this is as straight as it seems. I'm going to go with these aren't the same size. Okay. But we also have some assumptions here about what is a lie and what is truth. Okay. And interestingly enough, and this is what Seligman argues in some of his pieces, is that we tend to base our intuition of others in terms of this, right? In terms of looking and not looking stupid. So what he says is that we tend to look at people in two ways. We'll base your attentions either on the situation at hand or on your personality traits, right? But here's where it really comes interesting. We will give the people we know and trust the benefit of the doubt. We'll say, well, this person made this statement based on this situation, not based on a character flaw. But the people we don't know, the people that we don't trust, we tend to say, oh, it's a personality flaw. That person's got bad moral character, right? College professors have bad moral character. They trick us all the time. They give us bad grades. They're bad people, right? A lot of you guys in this middle pack felt that way, probably. Yeah, look at that. Okay. So in that discussion, though, what we're really saying is, what's a lie and what's a truth? And who can you trust? So some of us have a relationship. Some of you I know, right? And some of you are like, hey, Aaron's a pretty stand-up guy. I can trust what he has to say. And they gave me the benefit of the doubt. Some of you know me and like, no, we can't trust him at all. He plays tricks on us in every one of our classes. And you didn't trust me when I gave that circle set, right? Some of you don't know me, and then you made some assumptions about my personality traits. Okay, so what does that tell us? That tells us that lies can become truths and truths can become lies. And it's not about what's actually inherently true and evidential, but it is what you assume about the person saying the thing, right? That has way more to do with it than the actual evidence at hand. And this becomes pretty problematic, because we know that the way lies can become part of a tradition has nothing to do with its inherent structure, but has a lot to do with who is saying the lie. Okay, so here's the example that Solomon gives, that all you have to do is repeat things, and that can simply become a way of turning lies into truths. So what does that mean? You can lie to yourself. You can rewrite your own history. You can rewrite your own memories and continue to lie to yourself, and then you'll start to believe that lie. If you share that lie with enough people and say it over and over and over again, it becomes part of your reality. And then if you share that amongst the group, right, it becomes a larger situation. So it goes from a family to a community to a nation. Well, then that becomes part of the culture. And then if that group shares that same story from A to B, from generation to generation, then it becomes part of the tradition. That has nothing to do, though, if it's true or not true. Doesn't matter what it is, that's how it passes. And so that tells us that we've got to be skeptical of what we think we know, right? For instance, a lot of us will rely on common sense or wisdom. All right, so what is wisdom? Well, wisdom is knowledge plus experience. But most of the time when we hear people talk about wisdom, we talk about their experience and not so much about their knowledge, right? We end up relying on that past experience to tell us what is and what isn't. But that's an appeal to a traditional way of thinking. And the problem with appealing to tradition is that that's not actually a reason for something. It's actually the absence of a reason, right? Because we've always done something is by no way a definition for why we should continue to do something, right? We're actually lacking the argumentation, right? So another way to think about this is in many of our classes, I'm seeing my fellow faculty members out here, we all write papers, and in these papers, you have to have a thesis statement, you have to have supporting evidence for that thesis statement, right? That logical sequence tries to avoid this pitfall of just doing something because we've always done it. Okay, here's some examples where we've done things because we've always done it and we know that they're wrong. Slavery, right? Slavery was done because it was always done. Generation before me had slaves, so I will own slaves. We know that's inherently wrong, but if we were ruling only on the tradition, we would never have gotten past slavery. Women's suffrage. Women shouldn't vote. They don't own property, they're not important, they're not citizens. We again know this is wrong, but if we use that appeal to tradition, we just do what's always been done because it's always been done. These aren't reasons, right? They actually lack the reasons that we need. So it's a question about misinformation and how that information gets spread. Okay, so let me tell you a story. This is a great case in misinformation. So, African consumers were horrified by American baby food company's product packaging. Okay, so here's what happened. There was a baby food company, later determined to be Gerber, who wanted to sell its products in Africa. Well, Africa has a low literacy rate, and so they did their due diligence and studied Africa, and they said, okay, well, we have to market this to the population. So what we should do is we should follow what the other foods do. So if you want to buy a can of tuna in Africa, there's a picture of a tuna fish on the front, right? So you know, okay, that's got tuna inside, okay? Makes sense, right? So Gerber puts a baby on the front of their box. And the African nations are horrified by this. Those Westerners are trying to sell us babies in boxes. And they refuse to buy the boxes, right? And Gerber cannot understand, how come we cannot sell our products here? Okay? So this is an issue of misinformation. This was originally used in Harvard case law at Harvard Business Review. It's been taught numerous times in many different colleges, largely business colleges, but also marketing colleges. And the story has always been, we need to do a better job of understanding our market. There's one problem with this story. Be good if I got a good reveal here. It's not true. It's 100% false. It's an urban legend. In my research for tonight's presentation, I'm not calling NIU out. NIU, if you're watching, you're a great school. But NIU, I literally saw a business class recorded on YouTube teaching this lesson about the African nations were afraid of eating babies, right? And that just happened 3 years ago. Just 3 years ago. What's the problem with the story? The problem with the story is not that Gerber was trying to sell baby parks to African people. The problem is everything in that story tells us about us, not about someone else. What does it tell us? Well, first it tells us that the reason we should be globally aware, we should care about the planet, care about anybody living on this planet, is we could sell them things, right? The only reason people matter is because they're a market, that we can get them stuff and use them to buy that stuff, right? And we should have done a better job of understanding those people so we could sell them more stuff. Okay, well, that's problem one, because now we're using people and not really understanding them. We're just getting enough information, right, to get them our stuff. That's problem one. Problem two, it's an urban legend that has made it to major schools across this country and been used as evidence when, in fact, it's an absolute lie. You can spend 5 minutes on Google and you can trace the history of this urban legend and watch as it changes throughout history, right? It starts in the early 80s and it goes all the way up into today. Sometimes you change the people, sometimes you change the product, but it's the exact same legend passed on and passed on. And the internet only made it worse, right? It just got propagated all throughout. And why was it so easy for us to believe it? I think, and I think a lot of scholars would agree with me, the reason it was so easy for us to believe this is because, well, of course African people can't read. Of course African people would misunderstand this box. As if they didn't see a cow on a box and realize that that was milk and not ground up cows in there, right? As if these people couldn't think beyond this. As if they were all the same people. Notice that the story changed from baby food company to Gerber, but it didn't go from African people to actual Africans, right? It didn't mention specific countries. It generalizes all of Africa as if somehow Africa was this monolithic culture, that there's one African people. There are just as many diverse African peoples as there are any other place on Earth, right? Diversity is rampant in Africa, just like in America, just like in South America. You go all over the world and you'll see lots of diversity, right? So these people have very different cultures, but we don't give them the name. And what does that say about us? It says that perhaps the real urban legend here is that we're superior. The reason we were so willing to believe this is because it made us sound good. Even though we were doing a bad thing, it made us sound like we were doing a good thing, right? It still makes us look like the smart ones in the story. I think this case study should be shared in every business class around the planet, but not to teach people why you should be globally aware. I think it should be shared so we should teach ourselves about our own shortcomings, that we were so easily duped by this. So what can we actually learn from this? We can learn that maybe we shouldn't continue to think we're superior. Maybe we shouldn't look at people as a market and look at actual people instead. Because I want to say this then, what does this thing talk about? This case study shows us how we're ethnocentric. And maybe even worse, how we're Eurocentric, right? So what is ethnocentrism? What is Eurocentrism? It's this idea that your culture is the best and that you should judge other cultures based on your own culture, based on your experiences because you're right and they're wrong. I think we fall into this trap very easily, right? If I asked each one of you right now if you'd like to eat a spider, my hunch is most of you are going to say no to me. Is that a fair assumption? You can give me a general nod, right? Okay. If I pulled out a bunch of fried tarantulas, you're probably not going to be like, ooh, can't wait. Right? That's ethnocentric, though. We're immediately saying, oh, that seems gross. I don't want to eat that thing, right? That's an ethnocentric attitude because you're really saying, like, well, I don't want to eat that because that's weird and that's their culture and we do our own thing over here. We don't eat spiders. Sure you do. You pay top dollar for them. We just call them crabs, right? They're very closely related animals. They're very similar. But we love crab, right? We don't like spider. That's weird to us. That's the trap we fall into all the time. We fall into this trap of ethnocentrism by judging another culture based on our own experiences. Okay, so how can we overcome this, right? That's part of our part of tonight's global awareness idea. So Quinn has some ideas. I'm gonna tell you right now, Quinn's kind of an extreme guy, right? He's an environmentalist, and he doesn't have a whole lot of hope for us Westerners. I don't fall into that same trap. But here's some ideas I think are useful from him. Number one, he says that one of the reasons we continue to fall into our traps of ethnocentrism is we believe civilization's the best thing that's ever been created by humanity. We believe that civilization, Western civilization, really, is the best thing that's ever happened, and everything should become Westernized in that way, right? And largely he's saying that Western civilization also requires agriculture, and so he has this whole spiel about environmentalism, which, you know, I'll let the environmentalists do. But the idea is that civilization's what we need to sell around everywhere. And he argues that this is the biggest problem we run into. And so he has some ideas for us. They're not great, but there are some ideas for us. Number one, he says, if the world is to be saved, it will not be by old minds with new programs, but by new minds with no programs at all. I love this quote, because it basically says that everybody in this room that has any kind of authority, it's not us that's going to change the world, it's the kids, right? They're going to come up with new ideas that we didn't even think of, and they'll be able to figure this out. And we can go about how millennials and Gen Z are addicted to their phones, which they are, and all these other things about social media, which is true, but they're also super connected, right? They're connected in ways that we never were connected, right? And they're doing things that we never could have done. And so I tend to think that maybe Quinn was right, that we're on this path, that maybe new minds with no programs, oh boy, with no programs might be the solution. Because it points to another thing that Quinn mentions, and I think this is really important, that great thinkers are not limited by their thinking or by their knowledge. They're limited by their questions, right? Great thinkers can find all the answers. They know how to read and solve the problems of the world. They know these things. They can do this. The problem isn't that they can't find the information. The problem is that they don't know the questions to ask, because they're only curious about what they're curious about. Right? That's a very limiting way of seeing the world. It's very limiting in the sense that, well, all I care about is all that matters. So the problem is, programs create that. Okay, so like I said, Quinn's kind of a dark guy, and he tends to think that the only way we're getting out of this thing is when we end ourselves and then we'll start over. I'm not Quinn. I think that we have something between absolute destruction and today, right? Like, there's got to be something between that, right? Okay, so Quinn, though, says that he does believe that to get rid of programs means that we have to start thinking differently. And I love that. I think that's a great message. And so I think that we should think more positively and less negatively about the world. I think that the solution to a lot of our problems is optimism. Okay, so what is an optimistic worldview? Short answer to that is that you believe you can solve problems and that problems are not the end of the world, your personal world or the big world, that you can find a solution. Simply what optimism means, right? That the negative can be overcome. All right, so let's look at this quote really quick. There are more people alive today than have ever died. There are more people that are alive today than have ever died. Does it seem right? It seems right, right? Some of you are saying, no, good, good, be skeptics, don't listen to me, I don't know what I'm talking about, right? Yeah, you should definitely question everything I say. But some of you are going, oh yeah, man, that's totally true. Like, I can tell that there is problems with overpopulation on the planet today, and that we are gonna continue to grow at such exponential rates that we outnumber the people past before us. Okay, so it turns out it's a complicated answer, like most good questions are. It's never usually just black or white. Turns out that when Carl Hobb came up with this number in 2002, it's true depending on what you say is a human being, right? What's a human being? We could poll everybody in this room and we're gonna get 20 different answers, right? So what happens is Joe Cohen checks the numbers and says, okay, yes and no. That is true if you say that the population of humanity starts at XYZ versus another model, right? So I'm a humanist. I tend to believe in science and evolution. That means that I would start humanity somewhere around millions of years, right? Not thousands of years. Many of you in the audience might say, Aaron, you're crazy. I go by a young Earth model and humans start about 6,000 years ago, right? Cool, we can do that. That's no problem. The problem is we now have way different data points for trying to calculate that. And then how do you find out who's dead and who's alive, right? How do you find out, okay, I've got six rocks. Are they six different people? Are they the same person? But we got to figure all these things out, right? So how do we know who's been alive, who's been dead, and how do we calculate the number? The problem I have with the number isn't that it's true or false. I can go round and round with debates on that. My problem is what it implies. It implies that we're in trouble, that the world is overpopulated. We're all going to die. We're going to run out of resources, right? It's the great plot of half the science fiction novels and movies out there. Right? The only thing we can do now is we've used all our resources. We got to go settle Mars. Go find a Jupiter moon, right? This is where we're going to go because Earth's screwed. We ran out of stuff down here, right? We can't make corn. That's it. We're out. And I did a quick Twitter search. Quick. I literally typed in world and today or something like that. And the top, like, 30 things I read or how bad the world was. This is not a scientific experiment, but it was just a general idea here. The show is like, wow, we really think this place is pretty rotten. We don't have a whole lot of positive out there. I think I know why. I think it's because what Solomon says, we're negatively biased. We're rigged to think about the negative. It's a biological imperative. We learn better from the bad than we do from the good. You forget the good all the time, the bad stuff sticks out. That seems to make sense, right? Okay, so imagine we're all a tribe and we're in the savanna, we're walking through, and we're looking for some, you know, berries, because what we're doing, right? And a lion shows up. It's a bad day for someone, right? Slowest guy in our tribe just got eaten, okay? This is where we're at, right? We are gonna learn real quick, we should stop putting our head down like this the whole time, and look for lions, right? The bad sticks out in our head. It's wired in us. There's all kinds of neuroscience I'm not gonna go into right now, but you can definitely fact check me on this, that we tend to have the negative stuff surface, right? We do a poll of words, I give you a whole list of words, you're gonna remember cancer, bomb, and war way more often than you would remember baby, smile, and fun. It's the same reason that news media have continued to say, if it bleeds, it leads. What does that mean? It means the gruesome, the grotesque, the terrible will be the headline because it'll catch your attention. It's the thing we focus on. We're wired to look for the negative. But if we're wired to look for the negative and someone's constantly playing on that negative and never playing on the positive, it doesn't seem like we have a fair shot to make it optimism and make it sense, right? We tend to be pessimistic. Well, of course we are. Okay, so I'm an 80s kid, means I grew up Cold War and post-Cold War, and basically everybody that was older than me told me that the world's gonna be destroyed and you're screwed, kid, like tough, like you're an 80s kid, that's what's gonna happen to you, right? Okay, we had all kinds of bad things happening. You know, we're gonna pollute the heck out of this place until we can't live here anymore, the ozone's gonna be gone, we're gonna drop enough nuclear bombs that we kill the world 10 times over, right? Toxic waste is gonna spill through all of our lakes and give us three-eyed fish. Say goodbye to the pandas and all the other species on the planet. They're not gonna make it. And violence is gonna be rampant around the world. We have this pessimistic outlook. It seems like it's true, but I have this question. Can we actually destroy the world? Can we destroy the world? Remember what I said at the beginning of this presentation, what is the world? So can we destroy it? Harmed Oblige says, we need to rethink what we talk about when we talk about the world before we can even answer that question, right? He says that as Americans, we tend to think in terms of time and we've forgotten space. We like looking at things in hierarchies. We like looking at things structurally. We like looking at things in a timeline and cause and effect. But that's not the only way to look at stuff. In fact, he says, if we would just look at things in a more visual way, then we would see something that might be more important, and that's relationships, that's connections. And that might change our dialogue when it comes to destroying the world. So he says he's a geographer, and like geographers, artists and designers tend to fall into this way of looking at the world. They look at it spatially as opposed to chronologically. That spatially is going to be an important way to look at this before we can answer that question. All right, so let's go to space. I think it's a great place to go. All right, so this is the world. These far two right pictures, by the way, are often cited as the two most important pictures ever taken by human beings. It's a pretty subjective thing to say, I agree. But let me give you my case for why I kind of like it. First, the blue marble. I love this picture. It's just staggering to me because it shows how big that world is, right? Imagine this. Every single human being ever to live, dead and alive, is in that picture except for three, the three guys taking the picture from the moon, right? Everybody else is in that portrait. That's a pretty powerful picture, right? And before this picture, if you go through like the visuals of what we show is Earth, most of the time Earth is represented in its globe form, not its planet form. Right? You'll see most of those pictures show countries with dividing lines. What do we not see? There's no dividing lines, there's no countries. What do we mostly see? We mostly see clouds, right? We see a unified planet. We do not see a divided planet. I don't think we look at it that way. We should, I think. It's more humbling, especially when you look at this one. That's us. That's everybody. Every priest, every pauper, every murderer, every saint, every good guy, every bad guy. You name it, that's us. It's an awesome picture, right? This picture was taken by Voyager. So Carl Sagan, if you guys don't know who Carl Sagan is, he's a popularizer of science, and one of the things he was working on was Voyager, which was this way of taking pictures of all the planets across the solar system. By the time it gets past the formerly known planet as Pluto, Sagan says, you know what you should do? I know I saw a bunch of grumpets, I'm sorry. Okay. He says, you know what we should do? We should turn that thing around and take a picture of us. Let's look at us from the outside of the solar system. This is us. And this is a digitally enhanced version of that picture, right? In the original, it's like, I think there's a dot over there. Is it just all black? This picture, this image, is very humbling. Can we destroy this? Okay, so maybe we can. But it also shows us that there's a whole lot else out there. Can't destroy that, right? So even if we could destroy this entire dot, maybe we can, maybe we can't. There's more to it. And I think if we said that more often, it would remind us that we shouldn't be so arrogant that we can destroy this planet. I think that arrogance is a problem for us, right? It's a very ethno-Eurocentric way of seeing Earth. I'm seeing some of my students in the audience who definitely know this picture because they brought it up in my class a couple of times. Kudos to you guys for doing so. All right, so we get rid of our arrogance, we start becoming more humble, we start looking at the world as a bigger thing than we are. But then I still get this question often, and I think it's a valid question. Okay, so it's a big world and we can't destroy it. Should we care about it? Should we care about the world today? And I'm often like, I have to take a step back, right? Because like my natural instinct is like, of course we should care about it, and I like want to like, you know, go on my tirade about why we should care about it. And then I think to myself, you know, okay, wait, I gotta put myself in those people's shoes. Why should we care about it? What's important about the world? Why does the world matter? Okay, so de Blige actually has some reasons for us to work from, and I like his reasons, so I'm going to use those. De Blige says that he's got a bunch of practical or pragmatic reasons. So if he can't get you with the moralistic or the ethical ones, he should be able to get you with the practical ones. So if he can't get you with the practical ones, I don't know, maybe this is the wrong talk for you. There's another one coming over there, right? So the idea here is that you gotta at least start somewhere, and some of this stuff is just self-preservation stuff, right? Like, you should just, like, not wanna die, is his argument, okay? So, all right, he divides the world into two. It's not a great way to do things, but he does. He divides them as global or local. Another way would be first world, third world. We kinda gotten rid of that idea, right? But that there are global countries where people in those countries have access to anything they want and they can move around the planet. There are local countries that are stuck by their boundaries. He says that if we ignore all those locals, at bare minimum, we've lost a human resource. at bare minimum, those people have ideas in their heads that we'll never get back if we just let them die and never talk to them, right? And those solutions might be really important ones that we need. Remember Quinn's argument, we don't need old minds with more programs, we need new minds with no programs. They might be buried in these people that we're just letting die because we don't care about them, they're on the other side of the planet. So he says you can't do that. Pragmatic reason number one. Number two, that when you allow people to get to such desperate measures, they will turn to desperate solutions. So if you just ignore people, eventually they will try stuff that's bad for you too. Right? So like, you live in a nice Western world, it's very comfy. Crime and issues will come to you because there's a disparity of resources. Right? Some people will say, well, that won't hit me. I live in safe Sugar Grove, it'll never happen. Oh no, it could come to you too. Right? So he says, you should care at least about your own stuff. Okay? Locals are more prone to health problems because they don't usually have access to westernized medicine, and which means that they are more prone to get terrible diseases, and those terrible diseases are more likely to become epidemics. Again, you should care about getting sick. De Blasio says, again, don't want to die. I don't want to die from getting in some weird epidemic. We should cure the world's ailments so they don't spread it to me. Okay? He quotes things like even like the HIV epidemic that happened, right? So that starts in a local population and it makes it global. He says that's very possible with any of the diseases we have out there. We should try to eradicate them. If you have a group of people who don't have things, who have a disparity of resources, who don't have access to westernized medicine, and have no hope of fixing their problems, they will do whatever they can to get hope, even if that hope is false. So they'll turn to a false leader, a demagogue, if they have no choices. So again, if you don't care about the top three, then global issues are gonna be your problem because we're gonna end up fighting wars and having humanitarian issues because demagogues will run rampant. Okay, those are his practical reasons. He's got two really nice ethical ones that I think are probably, we should just all get on board with those too, but we'll see. Welfare and humanity. At the end of the day, humans should just have access to opportunity by being a human. There shouldn't be groups of people that don't get opportunity because they should get anything that any human being should have. They don't need our charity and our sympathy, they need opportunity. And the reason is because it's the decent thing to do. It's goodness. It's goodness for the greater good. It's goodness for your fellow human being. Human beings have agency and have rights, and that we should honor those. Those are his last two arguments. And he says, if you can't get to these two, then at least follow my first four. Okay? This idea of decency, though, I think we've lost. A lot of people say, oh, but the human race, the human species, we're just not decent. We're bad, selfish things. Maybe, maybe. But I tend to think it's in us all. Maybe I'm an optimist when it comes to decency, but I do believe that we can all be good to one another. Because not only is it good for the group, it's also good for you. And I think at the end of the day, we'll be self-preservationists if we need to be. And so Solomon continues where de Blasio goes with this idea that if you work with others, there's two things you can work on. You can work on your own self-talk and then the talk shared by groups. So your self-talk is that unconscious dialogue you have in your head, right? And oftentimes it's very negative. And he says you can make it positive. And then that self-talk spills out into regular talk into the group, which is also very negative. And he argues you can make that positive as well. The way you do it is thinking more optimistically than pessimistically. I'm never a fan of dividing things into two camps. He does. I think it's more of a spectrum, honestly. But I think what he's saying is think more optimistically more often and think pessimistically less often. Because when you think optimistically, you recognize there are problems in the world. Hurricanes are going to happen. Tornadoes are going to happen. Bad things are going to happen. But those aren't your fault. You can do things to make good in the world still. Well, the reverse of that is bad things are your fault and you just make bad and everything is bad. It just seems like a really terrible way to go about things. There's actually some negative psychology behind it as well. So Solomon's a humanist psychologist in that great kind of vein of Abraham Maslow. I know my college students know Abraham Maslow and the hierarchy of needs, right? You guys have all heard that. So this idea that humans are good at fixing their own psychoses. Humans are good at looking at their own pathologies and overcoming those with their strengths. It starts with these top three that the humanists came up with, and then Solomon adds these bottom two. And so the first three are that you're going to run into an adverse situation. Challenges are going to happen. You're going to have these situations, okay? To overcome that or to address that is your belief. Now, sometimes your belief is negative and it makes you pessimistic. Sometimes it's positive and it makes you optimistic. Those consequences from that then dictate your thought patterns. And he argues that you can fix those thought patterns through disputation. You can dispute negative self-talk, and by doing so, you can energize yourself and celebrate when you do it. His example is, you're driving to this amazing lecture at Waubonsee Community College, right? And it's a really crummy night. But you came out anyways, and on your way here, some jerk cuts you off and makes you do that, right? And you're like trying to get here safe. And you're like, ah, that guy. And you have all these lovely names you've called him, right? That's a negative, pessimistic way of seeing it. It's also attributing character flaws to a stranger. Remember my early slides, right? Attributing character flaws to a stranger. If that was your mother, you probably wouldn't have called her all those things. Maybe, I don't know your mom. Okay, so if it's someone you know, you make it situational. And so Solomon says, make it situational, right? Maybe that guy is going to his sick mom. Maybe he's got to get home to his kid. Maybe he's late for his shift and he's going to lose his job if he doesn't make it, right? So then the argument is, okay, you tell yourself, hey, I don't know this guy's story. I don't know his situation. I'm going to chalk that up to human beings having issues, not that this guy's a bad person. And when you do that, Solomon says, give yourself an attaboy. Attaboy, good job. You went positive instead of negative. I mean, he's not saying, like, celebrate with a birthday party here, like, ooh, I did this, right? But he's saying, like, reframe the way you think things because it will create a new pattern of thought. And it's amazing to me because we could certainly do this with everybody, right? Not just the guy that cut me off in traffic, but we can assume goodness in people and we can assume intentions are situational and less about their personality. Because that tells us about how we're connected as a group. So Solomon has a handful of more arguments that I'm going to briefly go over, just that when we have these negative thoughts, those are learned behaviors, just like optimism can be learned, and that when you use your strengths for good, something larger than you, you're going to build a social idea, a social connection. And then he goes on to say that if you want to overcome trauma and cope with problems, only optimists can really do this. Pessimists can't cope with it because by definition, they don't believe there's a solution. Everything is bad and they can't get out of the situation. So he's like, you gotta reframe all that discussion, right? So in order to kind of bring that in, we have to think about what's our connection then to the world? What's our connection to others? Okay, so let's go into where our connection falls. One of the things is our connection isn't just about us today, but it's about the people that are coming up after us. That we can choose to be altruistic if we want to be. And the more often we do that, we're likely to create more connection. And that when we establish those social bonds, we're gonna breed a culture of positivity as opposed to negativity. People with few social ties are two to three more times likely to suffer from major depression than people with strong social bonds. Okay, I'm not tricking you this time, this is a real thing, okay. So this is the real statistic. And what that says is, if we don't think of ourselves as a connected group and we think of ourselves as only isolated, we're gonna have more problems. This makes sense. People who are socially connected have a sense of belonging, have a sense of self-worth, a sense of security, and have emotional support systems, right? Life is better when you have these things. Life is poorer when you lack these things. And Solomon argues that if you want these things, the only way to really get there is to believe that others are good and to believe that things are optimistic. But there's obviously a counter argument to this. So I believe that we should, you know, have integrated groups of lots of different people. I think that's a great social bond. I'm not the only person with ideas about social bonds, and there are people who argue the opposite point to what I believe, right? Robert Putnam is often credited with this. He's like, yeah, social bonds are great. They should just be homogeneous ones, right? Heterogeneous bonds are not good. Homogeneous bonds are good. Hang out with the people that look like you and act like you and think like you and your life will be good. Okay, so following Solomon's argument, he's actually right. He's saying that you need bonds, you need a connection, and you'll have a good support system. And he wrote this book, Bowling Alone, and he argued that what ended up happening in our culture today is that the more diverse we got and the more multicultural we got, the more distrusting we got. We fell into a whole lot of judgment of personality and not so much situational. So much so that when we distrusted people who didn't look like us, that seemed natural. We started distrusting people who did look like us, and that was unnatural for him. And he's not alone. There's lots of research out there that shows homogeny works, right? Tucker Carlson, he's a pretty conservative guy. He was on a debate not too long ago, and he went through this whole thing about how multiculturalism is destroying the fabric of America. That to have a society and to have a country, you have to share values and share an idea. And by definition, multiculturalism is that you have many ideas. So you don't share anything. It's just a bunch of people living next door to each other, right? It's very similar to Putnam. These are not alone, right? There's lots of theories out there about homogeneity over heterogeneity. Okay. Does diversity weaken our social solidarity? Does it make us a weaker group, a lot more distrusting of a group, than if we had a more homogeneous society? Maybe. But I got some arguments against it, of course. Wouldn't come to global awareness and have you tell you, oh, you shouldn't have diversity. I don't like diversity, right? So I got some arguments against it. All right, so my arguments, and I often think that this is my most important slide. Like, I was looking through this and I was giving this, doing this presentation with my wife and then asked her my feedback and she was saying, oh, that's a good one. I was like, yeah, I like that one too. So here's my good one, okay? Here's my good slide. My good slide says that, okay, Robert Putnam, okay, Tucker Carlson, sure, you've proven that diversity is bad for us by your studies and you've got evidence and you've got support. But I've got some counterarguments. Counterargument number one. Here's the problem with homogeny. Homogeny biologically is not a great idea, okay? When we become specialists, when we become so focused and all of us are alike, we run out of biological diversity. Well, we don't make it that. Okay, so let's look at two. We got good old koala bear versus our raccoon. A specialist and a homogenist, a generalist and a diverse guy. Which one's gonna make it at the end of the world? Pretty sure it's gonna be this guy. This guy, you take out the eucalyptus leaf and they all die, right? That's it, right? You take out one tree with a disease or logging or whatever, you wanna kill koalas, just kill their trees, right? Specialists, by definition, only have a niche, and if that niche goes away, they're on their own. They can't make it. They're going to go out. A raccoon, aka the garbage panda, right? He's going to make it. He's got no problems, right? He's going to eat whatever's out there, and he's going to be fine. He's going to be just fine no matter what's going on. He's a survivor. He's not. Homogeneity biologically is never a good plan. Diversity biologically makes much more sense, right? And this myth that somehow American culture is being eroded by generalists, by heterogeneous populations, by diversity, is a myth that we had a homogeneous culture in the first place. We are not a unicultural planet. We are not a unicultural group of people. We are not a unicultural country. That is not how this has worked, right? There is no one American culture. Oh, people say, oh, there's an American culture, Aaron. It's American flags and cheeseburgers and it's American pie. Okay, none of those things are American. Not a one of the things you just said was American. Every one of those things comes from someplace else and was brought here, right? Every one of those ideas is someone else's repackaged as American. There is no American culture. There's a fluid, general idea of sharing and blending of languages and the arts and society and social ideas coming together to form what we call America today. America's not a place, America's an idea. It lives in our heads. There's no uni-America. There's always been a multi-America from day one to today. So to say that we're losing this culture, I don't even know what that culture is. That culture doesn't exist, it's a myth. It's a culture that may have been dominant. It's a culture that may have been shared by many groups, but it wasn't shared by everybody. And it's never been the only culture that we've had. So my final argument against that idea that we should have one culture, one cultural identity, one country is it's limiting. And at the end of the day, I want choice. I want to be a raccoon. I don't want to be a koala. I want to be able to have the choices and make those decisions. And the only way I get that is if I have lots of choices, right? Okay, so I'm going to give a shout out to one of my former students. She actually tried to explain, or re-explain, I should say, one of the really complicated arguments I was making in class. She's like, wait, you mean this? And I was like, yeah, that's actually what I mean. So she was really helpful, and I've been stealing her idea ever since, right? And she said, okay, look at this. If I ask you to draw a rainbow, and I give you a red crayon, your life is going to be pretty tough, right? Like, you're going to have a whole tower. You're going to make red, great. Go make green now. No, I can't, right? So you need more crayons. Okay, so if I give you three crayons, I give you red, yellow, and blue, sure, you can color a rainbow, no problem. Can you color all 300 million colors that humans can see? Yes. Is your life going to be awesome? Probably not. You're going to be sitting there coloring tiny little shades of pink and greens and all these other things, right? It's not going to work. But the more crayons you have, the easier that job becomes. And the more tools you have, and the different tools you have, the easier that job becomes, right? The beauty of diversity isn't that we just have different ideas. The beauty of diversity is that we have different ideas to choose from, different experiences to focus on and pull from in order to create solutions to our problems. All right, so what is this really saying then? So I'm going to go to Eastern Buddhism for a second because after all, I'm a humanities teacher, that's where I got to go. So Eastern Buddhism says that the beauty of diversity isn't just that you have more choices, more ideas, but that you aren't a you in the first place. You're already diverse. Let's just celebrate that. So here's what we do, okay? If we look at Indra's net, it's this model from Eastern thought that says, this is how the entire universe works. It's a beautiful model. Imagine the entire universe is a spider web, and in the corner of every spider web is a dewdrop. In those dewdrops is the reflection of every other dewdrop that exists in the universe. So no dewdrop is itself a dewdrop. It's simply a dewdrop reflecting all the other dewdrops. Well, this is us. This is people. We're a reflection of all the groups we live with. We're a reflection of the social bonds we make. We're a reflection with the parents and our children and our friends and our coworkers and colleagues. We're a reflection of everybody. You aren't a you. You're a part of a system. You're a part of an interconnected web. You are a reflection of everybody around you. And I would rather that reflection be diverse and give me more choices than just continually reflecting the same thing over and over again. Sure, I can line up 50 white guys and make them all look like me and have the same ideas. It's a pretty narrow-minded world. So there's this myth then that we tell each other that we're somehow individuals, that we're self-reliant. I've made me. I'm a self-made man. Are we? It's not been my experience. Has it been your experience? Are you only you because of all of the fruits of your labors? I know I stand on the shoulders of giants. Smarter men than me have come before me and said amazing things that I only get to where I'm at today because of what they did. I know I'm a reflection of my students, of my colleagues, of my wife, of my children. I'm a reflection of those people. They tell me who I am. And that's why I think the global mindset's important. So I'm going to use Pete to support me now. So Pete's the science guy, right? So if you didn't like my wishy-washy, you know, kind of touchy-feely kumbaya stuff, maybe the science thing will get you, right? Okay, so here's the science guy. Here's a guy that studies quantum physics, right? Or he did before he passed away. He studied over some of those famous quantum physicists of the day, right? He studied over David Bohm. He studied Einstein's theories. This is a brilliant guy. And he says, I cannot reconcile that I'm a me. I cannot reconcile that I'm self-reliant and individual. I cannot make this jive. And how does he solve it? He says, I'm not. I'm not alone. Each of our thoughts, this is a quote from his book, changes the world in a tiny but subtle way. Multiply this by the billions in the world, and human thought has an enormous impact. What is he saying? It's the butterfly effect. guys know the butterfly effect, right? So little tiny butterfly here in Illinois, well, not now, but you know, maybe in the spring, he'll come out, flap his wings, sends a tiny little ripple of a current in the air. That ripple of current adds to the other currents already existent, and we get a hurricane in Africa. No butterfly, no hurricane, right? He's saying human thought works the same way. Why? Because one thought anticipates the next and thereby contains it. The thought that comes afterward contains the memory of the trace of the former. None of the thoughts I've shared tonight, none of the thoughts you use are yours. They were given to you, and you repackage them, you polish them up, and you send them out. But they're not yours. They're based on others. So when we say, oh, I'm a self-made man, how? Are you using English? Because that isn't yours. You didn't invent that. Is your entire family reinventing the wheel and fire and all the things that we've done as human species? I doubt it. You're not self-made. You're part of a system. You're part of an interconnected web. That's what that global mindset means. We're part of this system. We're part of that web. And to say that that web ends here and starts somewhere else isn't true. Because those webs, those interconnections are deep rooted in us. There's an illusion of wholeness that's not a fact. It's a fact that's been shared over and over and over again as if it was true, but it's not a truth. You're not a whole. You're a whole that's in part another whole, and you're made up of wholes. I'm not a whole. I'm made up of cells, which are in themselves a whole. And those cells make a tissue, and those tissues make organs, and those organs make a body, and that body makes me. Okay, so now I'm part of wholes, but I'm also part of bigger wholes. Me is my family, is my community, is my society, is my world. There's no one whole. There's just lots of different components all interconnected. The danger arises when a culture takes its own story as the absolute truth and seeks to impose this truth on others as the yardstick of all knowledge and belief. That's a scientist saying that. It's a quantum physicist saying that, recognizing the issues in Western science, recognizing that he has to go to another system, another whole, and integrate that to make a bigger whole. When the Iroquois needed to make a decision, they thought of the implications of the seventh generation to come after. Do we do that? Do we think of the seventh generation? I'm not even sure we think of the next generation. I'm not even sure we think about tomorrow, right? I'm not. I'm thinking about right now, right? All right, so what does this mean? Let me put a bow on this whole thing and wrap this whole thing up. Let me land this plane. Okay, so here's where we're going. This speech was supposed to be about global awareness. I'm not sure it should have been. I think that's only part of the steps. So I'm borrowing a model here from a guy named Broadwell who says that basically you don't know what you don't know. When you do know you don't know it, doesn't mean you always agree with it. When you finally start to agree with it and learn it, doesn't mean you know it well. It's only here, where you don't have to think about it, that you really know it. Globally pessimistic means that I don't think about the world. I don't think about my interconnected webs. I don't think about my social networks. I don't think about being optimistic. I don't think about everybody else's perceptions. Just think about me. Global awareness means that I start to recognize that there's other people. Good job. Okay. What does that mean? You're aware. Well, aware just means you're awakened. You're aware. That's not enough. Let's go to literate. Let's become globally literate people. Remember, I started this by saying that I think that there's another kind of intelligence, there's a cultural intelligence. This means that I know there's other stuff out there. I want to learn about it. I want to understand it. I might not agree with it, but I want to know it exists. And then let's become globally optimistic. Let's think that that's a good thing. Let's think that globalism isn't some boogeyman come here to take your jobs and destroy American culture, but that we're here, that we're interconnected, and it's second nature for me to respect and understand others, and it's second nature for me to want to be curious about them, to have new ideas and new questions about other cultures. These are the competencies that a lot of like institutions say that we should have in order to be globally aware. Those things are nice. I think they're a starting point. They don't seem like enough for me. They basically say that you got to know stuff about other cultures. Good for you. You have to understand that there's influences in the world. Okay, again, good for you. That you're self-aware, you're aware of your own assumptions and that other people have assumptions. And that, you know, we start to develop this idea of ethics. I don't think that's the end. I think that's just the start. For me, I want to know about those differences and incorporate those differences in my life. I want to know how other minds work and reflect that in my web. I want to know the impact of local and global communities. I want to know what I'm doing that impacts the world today. I want real solutions, not just the problems. We spend so much time talking about the problems. Where are the answers? They don't have to be good answers. I just want some answers. I want to know that there's a human element in everything we say and do. I want to know what a worldview is. I want to create my own. I want to learn about others and how they create theirs. I want to incorporate that in mine. I want a bigger crayon box of different worldviews. I think those are how you become globally literate. And eventually, when that becomes secondhand, that's how you become globally optimistic. Hugh Evans is credited with this idea of creating the global citizen. This is something that I use in my classes. A lot of you are smiling because you have to go do this. The idea is that you become part of the globe and not just an individual. We're not just citizens of the country or the town. We're citizens of the world. We're citizens of the human race. How do you do that? You got to go meet someone different. That's literally an assignment in my class. You got to go find someone who looks and acts different than you intentionally and have a conversation with them. And know what it's like to live their life and why it's different than yours. It's not about like saying, oh, we shouldn't talk about race, shouldn't talk about gender, shouldn't talk about language inequality, all these things. I tell my students, no, go find this, take it head on, and learn from it. A lot of them hate me for it. But at the end of the day, I think they learn something really valuable because they could go meet this stranger, and that stranger's going to open up new worlds for them. And then maybe we become more curious. The only reason I care about culture so much is when I was 2 years old, I had a really forethinking grandmother who said, you know what, you're going to become a lifelong member of the National Geographic Society. For the rest of your life, a yellow border magazine is going to fill your parents' garage, and that's going to be what you're going to do. And I've been doing it for 36 years. And I love that magazine, to my wife's chagrin back there. I was exposed to lots of different cultures of the world really early on. I was like, wow, this is interesting. And it gave me questions that I never would have answered or asked if I hadn't seen those pictures and seen those maps and seen those articles. My parents also played a good hand in this. They took me to the Field Museum all the time. You know anything about that? That place definitely opens up your culture. To this day, I bring parts of the Field Museum into my class. I bring artifacts from the Field Museum to my class and I say, look at these people making. Look at what they're doing, right? And it's really an interesting way of starting that conversation. Creates new questions. Take a diversity class. Take my class, right? If you don't want to take my class, there's plenty of diversity classes on the campus. If you don't want to take my class, you don't want to take a class on campus, watch some TED Talks, go to conferences, go to things intentionally looking for diversity. Make that your mission, not the after effect. I think this is the key to global optimism. Frank L. Baum, the guy that wrote Wizard of Oz, said that the reason we're here, paraphrasing, the reason we're here is to make the world a better place than we found it. I believe we can do that. Some people say, oh, Aaron, it's too big. You can't do that. I think we can. That's what I think is the difference between being globally pessimistic and globally optimistic. Remember I asked you, does the world need to be saved? Seems like a long, long time ago, right? I don't know about the world. Maybe humanity. Does humanity need to be saved? And how so? How do we do it? I can give you all the answers that research says. You got to change your ways of thinking, become more humble, be altruistic, you know, unlearn the things you learn, take responsibility, look for meaning. I give you all this research, but at the end of the day, I just think if this is the thing we think, make the world a better place, we will make the world a better place. At the end of the day, I think the only thing we really need to focus on is, I'm a global optimist. I want the world to be a better place. I'm going to do stuff to get there. That's what I believe. I want to know what you believe. Thank you, everybody. I really appreciate the time.